you're watching New York State Legislative Report with Senator George Maziarz. I'm Julia Locandy. Today, the senator and I are going to talk about what's going on in the New York State Senate. It's great to be with
Julia,
Senator.
It's good to be with you, too.
So the budget was passed last week. The
budget was passed, and now it's time to move on to the legislative portion of the session. And, of course, that's very important. And hopefully, with the budget being passed actually early, we're going to have time to, you know, address a lot of issues, ethics reform, campaign finance reform, criminal justice reform, a lot of things that have been lacking for a long time.
Right. So tell us, today the Senate's going to act on Abbagail's Law. Tell us
yes.
who Abbagail is and her story.
Abbagail's Law is named after Abbagail Buzzard, a beautiful little 8-year-old girl. There she is in Orleans County. Abbagail's father was at a party, and he had way too much to drink. And he actually wanted to go and get more alcohol at a local convenience store. And realizing that he was too drunk to drive, but still being irresponsible, he got a 17-year-old relative to drive him to the convenience store to get more alcohol. And he put three children, actually, in the back seat, including his 8-year-old daughter, Abbagail. So he was a supervising driver with a 17-year-old driver after dark. Who only had a learner's permit. On the way to the convenience store, the driver, you know, 17 years old, it's dark, rural area, Orleans County, ran off the road, went into a culvert, it was raining, and Abbagail was killed in that accident. And unfortunately, I know he worked very hard, Abigail's mother, Nicole, the district attorney, Joe Cardone, obviously wanted to make this individual, Abigail's father, pay a heavy criminal penalty for that unbelievable lack of judgment. But in the law, there's really nothing that they could have charged him with. Eventually, he did end up pleading to a charge and did spend 6 months in jail. But 6 months for the life of an 8-year-old beautiful little girl clearly was not enough. And what this law does is it will increase the criminal penalties for an individual who's a supervising driver of a person with just a learner's permit who allows that person to drive while they, the supervising driver, are under the influence of drugs or alcohol. He should have paid a heavier criminal price for the death of that beautiful little girl.
Yeah, that's really unfortunate.
And I just want to mention Senator Chuck Fuscillo, chairman of the Senate Transportation Committee, has been just an ardent champion of stiffening up the drunk driving laws in the state of New York. And today we're going to take a giant step. And I can only call upon, you know, my colleagues in the New York State Assembly. Assemblyman Steve Hawley has really tried hard to move this thing in the Assembly. And, you know, the Assembly is not very prone to doing criminal justice legislation, increasing criminal penalties. But clearly, if ever there was an example in this state where criminal penalties should be increased, it's a person who's under the influence of drugs or alcohol who convinces an individual, a 16, 17-year-old with just a learner's permit, to drive a car. That is, as far as I'm concerned, it's as equal to that individual themselves getting into the car and driving it.
Mm-hmm. So moving on now to the budget. Tell me what you believe the overall outcome, some of the highlights.
Well, I think that, you know, conceptually addressing the budget gap that we had, the $10 billion gap that we had, without increasing any taxes, fees, assessments, that I think was the real highlight of this budget. You know, during last year's campaign across the state, elected officials talked about, you know, addressing, had a lot of different ideas on how to address the budget. Governor Cuomo did. And I think that, you know, at least from the legislative standpoint, that was a promise made and we were able to keep it. I mean, this budget has no increase in taxes, no increase in assessments. It addresses the budget deficit by reducing spending. I mean, there's, I think, almost a 3% cut in spending. It's several billion dollars. I think last year's was $137 billion. This year's budget is, I think, just a little over $133. So it addresses the budget deficit long-term. Clearly, school aid has been reduced from the state. and there's going to be a lot of very difficult decisions going forward. And there was the one area that where there were restorations made was in school aid, but still there's an overall cut. I think consolidation of state agencies was something that's been talked about for years around here. This budget actually implemented that consolidation program. So I think the fact that there were no new mandates passed on to local governments, on to school districts, was a very positive aspect of this budget. Now, there were some disappointments in the budget, too. I was disappointed that on the Medicaid Reform Task Force, issues of spending were addressed, but the number of options that we offer in the Medicaid program really were not diminished in a significant degree. That's clearly something. The Medicaid program is going to continue to expand in this state, and it's going to continue to cost more money in this state if we don't address those options. And it's very difficult to take something away that people are getting, a service that they're getting. But unless we do that, I just don't think, I don't see how we can control those costs going forward. So that's clearly something we have to look at.
Right. Healthcare as well as education take up the largest portion of the budget. You mentioned the cuts to education, but you were able to restore some money.
We were able to restore those. There were some districts that, I thought were initially very negatively impacted, the small city school districts, the rural and suburban school districts. This budget restored some of that money, not very much. There's an interesting article in Sunday's Buffalo News about the aid that was restored, the aid to school districts, the cost per pupil in some districts versus what the student population, in almost every instance they showed, where costs have risen dramatically and student population has declined dramatically. So, it's very difficult today with education and local school property taxes. That's something that we continue to wrestle with. Hopefully with these restorations, I know that there's going to be cutbacks in local school districts. There's no question that that's going to happen. I think that superintendents have known that was going to happen. I think there's a whole lot of, disagreement out there about administration, about superintendent salaries. The governor's talked about that a great deal. I saw some preliminary numbers from some school districts where there were going to be layoffs, and it looked to me like all the layoffs were coming from either the non-teaching staff or within the teaching staff, and very few that I've seen within the administrative staff. I mean, we look at some districts. There was another article in the Buffalo News, I keep referring to them, but about the increase in administrative staffs in some of the big city school districts like Buffalo and Rochester. Clearly that should be looked at before they look at laying off teachers.
Right. Although the budget didn't include UB 2020, you said really on the Senate floor, I'd like to play that clip, that it's come a long way.
It's come a whole long way, and it's a lot better than it was in 2009, I can tell you that.
Yeah. Let's take a look.
Sure.
There are aspects of UB 2020 in this budget. There's a lot of differences between what the UB 2020, Senator Stavisky, that was passed in 2009 and the UB 2020 bill that was sponsored by Senator Grisanti. Obviously, that bill, I think, had almost 20 members in opposition. This one had but one. There is a great deal of satisfaction with the support of the governor. That is different. We didn't have that before. The Buffalo News editorial board is satisfied with where the direction that we are going in. Funding to implement UB 2020 is contained in this budget. I think it's a lot further ahead than it's ever been before.
You can hear the protesters in the back. What was that like, just listening to that?
Well,
it sounded like
they clearly have a right to protest. The Capitol was open to them. I think that there were certain areas like the Senate gallery, the Assembly gallery, that were not open to them. I think that, you could clearly see that they were going to be extremely loud and vocal. And I think that the state police made the decision. It wasn't the Senate itself. It wasn't the Senate leadership, I'm told. It was the state police who made the decision that the protesters were going to be confined to a certain area of the Capitol. They were allowed inside. They were all over the place. I tend to stop into the Capitol Library a lot, and they were the place was full. So they certainly were able to get their points across. It's very difficult. I mean, I think for the most part, they didn't want to cut anything in the budget, but that was not an option.
Right. Property tax cap is another item that it was not in the budget, but you said you were going to fight for to pass this session.
Yes, and I think that the governor has made a commitment to do the property tax cap. Now, we can't do a property tax cap that doesn't have meaningful mandate relief in it. And a lot of that has to goes back to what I said about the options available under the Medicaid system. That would relieve county costs a great deal in New York State. The Senate has passed the property tax cap in conjunction with the governor. The governor has made it his top off-budget priority, and I think when it comes, I think the governor's priorities are ethics reform and a property tax cap.
Right. This budget was very pro-jobs. Let's cut to a remark on the floor right now where you're explaining why Western New York is losing population because of this.
The city of Niagara Falls, an area that I do not represent, but in the city of Niagara Falls there are 6 elementary schools. In 4 of those 6 elementary schools, 94% of the kids live below the federal poverty level. These are kids in kindergarten through the 6th grade. They don't choose to live in poverty. They live in poverty for the same reason that the population in Buffalo and Niagara Falls is declining at such a rapid rate, because their parents don't have jobs, because there are not economic opportunities for people to make a decent living in Western New York. And juxtapose that with the fact that just down the road is the largest producer of hydroelectricity in the United States, in the northeastern United States of America. And the best use, and John Dyson understands, that the best use, the best way to create economic opportunities and create jobs is by utilizing hydropower. This is an excellent nominee that the governor gave to us. I'd have to say, if I just had one qualification, John, I wish that you were from Niagara County, because Niagara County, more than anything, deserves a seat on the Board of Trustees of the Power Authority. But, Mr. President, I think that this is an excellent nomination that the governor made, and I would urge all of my colleagues to join me and the members of the Energy Committee, which unanimously supported this nominee.
So a new appointee to the Power Authority.
New appointee to the Power Authority, John Dyson. He clearly understands the business of energy, very well qualified. He was a former commissioner of commerce in New York. He was a commissioner of agriculture in New York. I think he's going to do a very good job on the Power Authority. I'm sure there's going to be areas of disagreement that he and I have along the road, but clearly Governor Cuomo, I thought it was interesting that Governor Cuomo, his first nominee for a non-commissioner's position was John Dyson on the Power Authority. I think Governor Cuomo sees the Power Authority as being a key element for economic redevelopment of upstate New York, and it really has to be. It's the greatest asset upstate New York has, both, and I'm not only talking about Western New York, but I talk about the North Country with the St. Lawrence project too. Mm-hmm. And there's already a project that Mr. Dyson is working on that the Power Authority was going to sign a contract and cost hundreds of millions of dollars, that they're taking a second look at already because of his intervention, and I applaud him for it. I mean, asking questions, getting in there, that's what I like to see from trustees, from people who volunteer to be on these boards. Don't just take the word of the administration or the executives of a particular agency. Ask questions, do your due diligence, look into where the money's going. That's what John Dyson's going to do, I guarantee it.
Absolutely. One more programming note. I think that your constituents would like to know that your district office is moving.
Yes, changed my office from the town of Wheatfield back to the city of Lockport. I'm in what's called Allrich City Center, 175 Lockport Street. I'm sorry, at 175 Walnut Street. Did I say Lockport? Walnut Street, in Lockport. And it's right downtown, and it's easily accessible to everyone. I think we're having a little bit of trouble with the telephone yet, switching over the phones, but I'm sure that'll work itself out, too. We have a new number, and it's on the screen there, so.
Email is good, right?
Stop by. Yep, email is good.
Thanks so much for being with us. For any additional information, maziarz.nysenate.gov.